that's the way.
It was 3 in the morning, and the telephone rang again. Not that the hour mattered. Al Dewey was wide awake anyway, and so were Marie and their sons, 9-year-old Paul, 12-year-old Alvin Adams Dewey Jr. For who could sleep in a house, a modest one-story house, where all night the telephone had been sounding every few minutes? As he got out of bed, Dewey promised his wife, "This time I'll leave it off the hook," but it was not a promise he dared keep. True, many of the calls came from news-hunting journalists or would-be humorists or theorists. "Al, listen, fella, I got this deal figured. It's suicide and murder. I happen to know Herb was in a bad way financially. He was spread pretty thin. So what does he do? He takes out this big insurance policy, shoots Bonnie and the kids, and kills himself with a bomb. A hand grenade stuffed with buckshot." And anonymous persons with poison pen minds, "Know them, LS foreigners, don't work, give parties, serve cocktails, where's the money come from? Wouldn't surprise me a darn if they ain't at the roots of this clutter problem." Or nervous ladies, alarmed by the gossip going around, rumours that knew neither ceiling nor cellar. "Alvin, now I've known you since you were a boy, and I want you to tell me straight out whether it's so. I loved and respected Mr. Clutter, and refused to believe that that man, that Christian, I refused to believe he was chasing after women." But most of those who telephoned were responsible citizens wanting to be helpful. "I wonder if you've interviewed Nancy's friend, Sue Kidwell. I was talking to the child and she said something that struck me. She said the last time she ever spoke to Nancy, Nancy told her Mr. Clutter was in a real bad mood. Had been the past 3 weeks. That she thought he was very worried about something. So worried he'd taken to smoking cigarettes." Either that or the callers were people officially concerned. Law officers and sheriffs from other parts of the state. "Oh, this may be something, maybe not, but a bartender here says he overheard two fellows discussing the case in terms made it sound like they had a lot to do with it." And while none of these conversations had as yet done more than make extra work for the investigators, it was always possible that the next one might be, as Dewey put it, the break that brings down the curtain. On answering the present call, Dewey immediately heard, "I want to confess." He said, "To whom am I speaking, please?" The caller, a man, repeated his original assertion and added, "I did it! I killed them all!" "Yes," said Dewey. "Now, if I could have your name and address." "Oh, no, you don't," said the man, his voice thick with inebriated indignation. "I'm not going to tell you anything, not till I get the reward. You send the reward, then I'll tell you who I am. That's final." Dewey went back to bed. "No, honey," he said, "nothing important, just another drunk." What did he want? He wanted to confess, provided we sent the reward first. A Kansas paper, the Hutchinson News, had offered $1,000 for information leading to the solution of the crime. "Alvin, are you lighting another cigarette? Honestly, Alvin, can't you at least try to sleep?" He was too tense to sleep. Even if the telephone could be silenced, too fretful and frustrated. None of the leads had led anywhere except perhaps down a blind alley toward the blankest of walls. Bobby Rupp. The polygraph machine had eliminated Bobby. And Mr. Smith, the farmer who tied rope knots identical with those used by the murderer, he too was a discarded suspect, having established that on the night of the crime he'd been off in Oklahoma, which left the Johns, father and son. But they had also submitted provable alibis. So, to quote Harold Nye, it all adds up to a nice round number. 0. Even the hunt for the grave of Nancy's cat had come to nothing. Nevertheless, there had been one or two meaningful developments. First, while sorting Nancy's clothes, Mrs. Elaine Seltzer, her aunt, had found tucked in the toe of a shoe a gold wristwatch. Second, accompanied by a KBI agent, Mrs. Helm had explored every room at River Valley Farm, toured the house, in the expectation that she might notice something awry or absent. And she had. It happened in Kenyon's room. Mrs. Helm looked and looked, paced round and round the room with pursed lips, touching this and that. Kenyon's old baseball mitt. Kenyon's mud-spattered work boots. His pathetic abandoned spectacles. All the while she kept whispering, "Something here is wrong. I feel it, I know it, but I don't know what it is." And then she did know. "It's the radio. Where's Kenyon's little radio?" Taken together, these discoveries forced Dewey to consider again the possibility of plain robbery as a motive. Surely that watch had not tumbled into Nancy's shoe by accident. She must, lying there in the dark, have heard sounds, footfalls, perhaps voices, that led her to suppose thieves were in the house. And so, believing that, must have hurriedly hidden the watch, a gift from her father that she treasured. As the radio, a grey portable made by Zenith, no doubt about it, the radio was gone. All the same, Dewey could not accept the theory that the family had been slaughtered for paltry profit. A few dollars on a radio? To accept it would obliterate his image of the killer, or rather killers. He and his associates had definitely decided to pluralise the term. The expert execution of the crimes was proof enough that at least one of the pair commanded an immoderate amount of cool-headed slyness and was, must be, a person too clever to have done such a deed without calculated motive. Then, too, Dewey became aware of several particulars that reinforced his conviction that at least one of the murderers was emotionally involved with the victims and felt for them, even as he destroyed them, a certain twisted tenderness. How else to explain the mattress box? The business of the mattress box was one of the things that most tantalised Dewey. Why had the murderers taken the trouble to move the box from the far end of the basement room and lay it on the floor in front of the furnace, unless the intention had been to make Mr. Clutter more comfortable, to provide him, while he contemplated the approaching knife, with a couch less rigid than cold cement? And in studying the death scene photographs, Dewey had distinguished other details that seemed to support his notion of a murderer now and again moved by considerate impulses. Or, he could never quite find the word he wanted, something fussy and soft, those bed covers. Now what kind of person would do that? Tie up two women the way Bonnie and the girl were tied, and then draw up the bed covers, tuck them in, like sweet dreams and good night. Or the pillow under Kenyon's head. At first I thought maybe the pillow was put there to make his head a simpler target. Now I think, no, it was done for the same reason the mattress box was spread on the floor, to make the victim more comfortable. But speculations such as these, though they absorbed Dewey, did not gratify him or give him a sense of getting somewhere. A case was seldom solved by fancy theories. He put his faith in facts, sweated for and sworn to. The quantity of facts to be sought and sifted, and the agenda planned to obtain them, promised perspiration aplenty, entailing as it did the tracking down, the checking out of hundreds of people, among them all former River Valley Farm employees, friends, family, anyone with whom Mr. Clutter had done business, much or little, a tortoise crawl into the past. For as Dewey had told his team, "We have to keep going till we know the Clutters better than they ever knew themselves. Until we see the connection between what we found last Sunday morning and something that happened maybe 5 years ago, the link got to be one. Got to." Dewey's wife dozed, but she awakened when she felt him leave their bed, heard him once more answering the telephone, and heard from the nearby room where her son slept, sobs, a small boy crying. "Paul?" Ordinarily, Paul was neither troubled nor troublesome. Not a whiner, ever. He was too busy digging tunnels in the backyard or practising to be the fastest runner in Finney County. But at breakfast that morning, he had burst into tears. His mother had not needed to ask him why. She knew that, although he understood only hazily the reasons for the uproar around him. He felt endangered by it, by the harassing telephone, by the strangers at the door, by his father's worry-wearied eyes. She went to comfort Paul. His brother, 3 years older, helped. "Paul," he said, "you take it easy now, and tomorrow I'll teach you to play poker." Dewey was in the kitchen. Marie, searching for him, found him there, waiting for a pot of coffee to percolate, and with the murder scene photographs spread before him on the kitchen table. Bleak stains, spoiling the table's pretty fruit-patterned oilcloth. Once he had offered to let her look at the pictures. She had declined. She had said, "I want to remember Bonnie the way Bonnie was, and all of them." He said, "Maybe the boys ought to stay with Mother." His mother, a widow, lived not far off. In a house she thought too spacious and silent, the grandchildren were always welcome. For just a few days, until... "Alvin, do you think we'll ever get back to normal living?" Mrs. Dewey asked. Their normal life was like this. Both worked, Mrs. Dewey as an office secretary, and they divided themselves between the household chores, taking turns at the stove and the sink. "When Alvin was sheriff, I know some of the boys teased him, used to say, 'Look yonder, here comes Sheriff Dewey, tough guy, totes a six-shooter, but once he gets home, off comes the gun, and on goes the apron.'" At that time, they were saving to build a house on a farm that Dewey had bought in 1951, 240 acres several miles north of Garden City. If the weather was fine, and especially when the days were hot and the wheat was high and ripe, he liked to drive out there and practice his draw, shoot crows, tin cans, or, in his imagination, roam through the house he hoped to have, and through the garden he meant to plant, and under trees yet to be seeded. He was very certain that some day his own oasis of oaks and elms would stand upon these shadeless plains. Some day, God willing. A belief in God, and the rituals surrounding that belief. Church every Sunday, grace before meals, prayers before bed, were an important part of the Dewey's existence. "I don't see how anyone can sit down at a table without wanting to bless it," Mrs. Dewey once said. "Sometimes, when I come home from work, well, I'm tired, but there's always coffee on the stove, and sometimes a steak in the icebox. The boys make a fire to cook the steak, and we talk and tell each other our day, and by the time supper's ready, I know we have good cause to be happy and grateful. So I say, 'Thank you, Lord,' not just because I should, but because I want to." "Now," Mrs. Dewey said, "Alvin, answer me. Do you think we'll ever have a normal life again?" He started to reply, but the telephone stopped him. The old Chevrolet left Kansas City, November the 21st, Saturday night. Luggage was lashed to the fenders and roped to the roof. The trunk was so stuffed it could not be shut. Inside, on the back seat, two television sets stood, one atop the other. It was a tight fit for the passengers. Dick, who was driving, and Perry, who sat clutching the old Gibson guitar, his most beloved possession. As for Perry's other belongings, a cardboard suitcase, a grey Zenith portable radio, a gallon jug of root beer syrup. He feared that his favourite beverage might not be available in Mexico. And two big boxes containing books, manuscripts, cherished memorabilia. And hadn't Dick raised hell, cursed, kicked the boxes, called them £500 of pig slop? These two were part of the car's untidy interior. Around midnight, they crossed the border into Oklahoma. Perry, glad to be out of Kansas, at last relaxed. Now it was true. They were on their way. On their way and never coming back. Without regret, as far as he was concerned, for he was leaving nothing behind and no one who might deeply wonder into what thin air he'd spiralled. The same could not be said of Dick. There were those Dick claimed to love. 3 sons, a mother, a father, a brother, persons he hadn't dared confide his plans to or bid goodbye. Though he never expected to see them again. Not in this life. Clutter English Vows Given in Saturday Ceremony. That headline, appearing on the social page of the Garden City Telegram for November the 23rd, surprised many of its readers. It seemed that Beverly, the second of Mr. Clutter's surviving daughters, had married Mr. Vere Edward English, the young biology student to whom she had long been engaged. Miss Clutter had worn white, and the wedding, a full-scale affair. Mrs. Leonard Cohen was soloist, and Mrs. Howard Blanchard organist, had been solemnised at the First Methodist Church, the church in which 3 days earlier the bride had formally mourned her parents, her brother, and her younger sister. However, according to the Telegram's account, Vere and Beverly had planned to be married at Christmas time. The invitations were printed, and her father had reserved the church for that date. Due to the unexpected tragedy, and because of the many relatives being here from distant places, the young couple decided to have their wedding on Saturday. The wedding over, the Clutter kinfolk dispersed. On Monday, the day the last of them left Garden City, the Telegram featured on its front page a letter written by Mr. Howard Fox of Oregon, Illinois, a brother of Bonnie Clutter. The letter, after expressing gratitude to the townspeople for having opened their homes and hearts to the bereaved family, turned into a plea. "There is much resentment in this community," that is Garden City, wrote Mr. Fox. "I have even heard on more than one occasion that the man, when found, should be hanged from the nearest tree. Let us not feel this way. The deed is done, and taking another life cannot change it. Instead, let us forgive, as God would have us do. It is not right that we should hold a grudge in our hearts. The doer of this act is going to find it very difficult indeed to live with himself. His only peace of mind will be when he goes to God for forgiveness. Let us not stand in the way, but instead give prayers that he may find his peace." The car was parked on a promontory where Perry and Dick had stopped to picnic. It was noon. Dick scanned the view through a pair of binoculars. Mountains, hawks wheeling in a white sky, a dusty road winding into and out of a white and dusty village. Today was his second day in Mexico, and so far he liked it fine, even the food. At this very moment he was eating a cold, oily tortilla. They'd crossed the border at Laredo, Texas, the morning of November the 23rd, and spent the first night in San Luis Potosi brothel. They were now 200 miles north of their next destination, Mexico City. "Know what I think," said Perry. "I think there must be something wrong with us to do what we did."
"Did what?"
"Out there." Dick dropped the binoculars into a leather case. Luxurious receptacle initialled HWC. He was annoyed. Annoyed as hell. Why the hell couldn't Perry shut up? Christ Jesus, what damn good did it do always dragging the goddamn thing up? It really was annoying. Especially since they'd agreed, sort of, not to talk about the goddamn thing, just forget it. "There's got to be something wrong with somebody who'd do a thing like that," Perry said.
"Deal me out, baby," Dick said. "I'm a normal."
And Dick meant what he said. He thought himself as balanced, as sane as anyone. Maybe a bit smarter than the average fellow, that's all. But Perry, there was, in Dick's opinion, something wrong with little Perry. To say the least, last spring when they'd celled together at Kansas State Penitentiary, he had learned most of Perry's lesser peculiarities. Perry could be such a kid, always wetting his bed and crying in his sleep.
"Dad, I've been looking everywhere. Where you been, Dad?"
And often Dick had seen him sit for hours just sucking his thumb and poring over them phony damn treasure guides, which was one side, and there were others. In some ways, old Perry was spooky as hell. Take, for instance, that temper of his. He could slide into a fury quicker than 10 drunk Indians. And yet you wouldn't know it. He might be ready to kill you, but you'd never know it. "Not to look at or listen to," Dick once said. For however extreme the inward rage, outwardly Perry remained a cool, young tough with eyes serene and slightly sleepy. The time had been when Dick had thought he could control, could regulate the temperature of these sudden cold fevers that burned and chilled his friend. He had been mistaken, and in the aftermath of that discovery, had grown very unsure of Perry, not at all certain what to think, except that he felt he ought to be afraid of him, and wondered really why he wasn't. "Deep down," Perry continued, "way, way rock bottom, I never thought I could do it, a thing like that." "How about the nigger?" Dick said. Silence. Dick realized that Perry was staring at him. A week ago, in Kansas City, Perry had bought a pair of dark glasses, fancy ones with silver-lacquered rims and mirrored lenses. Dick disliked them. He had told Perry he was ashamed to be seen with anyone who'd wear that kind of flit stuff. Actually, what irked him was the mirrored lenses. It was unpleasant having Perry's eyes hidden behind the privacy of those tinted, reflecting services. "But a nigger," said Perry, "that's different." The comment, the reluctance with which it was pronounced, made Dick ask, "Or did you kill him like you said?" It was a significant question, for his original interest in Perry, his assessment of Perry's character and potentialities, was founded on the story Perry had once told him of how he had beaten a coloured man to death. "Sure I did, only a nigger. It's not the same." And then Perry said, "No, what it is that really bugs me about the other thing, it's just, I don't believe it, that anyone can get away with a thing like that. Because I don't see how it's possible to do what we did and just 100% get away with it. I mean, that's what bugs me. I can't get out of my head that something's got to happen." Though as a child he had attended church, Dick had never come near a belief in God. Nor was he troubled by superstitions. Unlike Perry, he was not convinced that a broken mirror meant 7 years' misfortune, or that a young moon, if glimpsed through glass, portended evil. But Perry, with his sharp and scratchy intuitions, had hit upon Dick's one abiding doubt. Dick, too, suffered moments when that question circled inside his head. Was it possible? Were the two of them, honest to God, going to get away with doing a thing like that? Suddenly he said to Perry, "Now, just shut up!" Then he gunned the motor and backed the car off the promontory. Ahead of him, on the dusty road, he saw a dog trotting along in the warm sunshine. Mountain hawks wheeling in a white sky. When Perry asked Dick, "Know what I think?" he knew he was beginning a conversation that would displease Dick, and one that, for that matter, he himself would just as soon avoid. He agreed with Dick. Why go on talking about it? But he could not always stop himself. Spells of helplessness occurred, moments when he remembered things. Blue light exploding in a black room. The glass eyes of a big toy bear. And when voices, a particular few words, started nagging his mind. "Oh no, oh please, no, 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 don't, oh please, no, don't, please." And certain sounds returned. A silver dollar rolling across a floor. Bootsteps on hardwood stairs and the sounds of breathing. The gasps, the hysterical inhalations of a man with a severed windpipe. When Perry said, "I think there must be something wrong with us," he was making an admission he hated to make. After all, it was painful to imagine that one might not just be right. Particularly if whatever was wrong was not your own fault, but maybe a thing you were born with. Looking at his family, look at what had happened there. His mother, an alcoholic, had strangled to death on her own vomit. Of her children, two sons and two daughters, only the younger girl, Barbara, had entered ordinary life, married, begun raising a family. Fern, the other daughter, jumped out of a window of a San Francisco hotel. Perry had ever since tried to believe she slipped, for he loved Fern. She was such a sweet person, so artistic, a terrific dancer. She could sing too. If she had ever had any luck at all with her looks and all, she could have got somewhere, been somebody. He was sad to think of her climbing over a windowsill and falling 15 floors. And there was Jimmy, the older boy, Jimmy, who had one day driven his wife to suicide and killed himself the next. And then he heard Dick say, "Deal me out, baby, I'm a normal." Wasn't that a horse's laugh? Never mind, let it pass. Deep down, Perry continued, way, way rock bottom, I never thought I could do it, a thing like that. And at once he recognised his error. Dick would, of course, answer by asking, "How about the nigger?" When he told Dick that story, it was because he had wanted Dick's friendship, wanted Dick to respect him, think him hard, as much the masculine type as he had considered Dick to be. And so one day, after they had both read and were discussing a Reader's Digest article entitled, "How Good a Character Detective Are You?" As you wait in the dentist's office or a railway station, try studying the giveaway signs in people around you. Watch the way they walk. For example, a stiff-legged gait can reveal a rigid, unbending personality. A shambling walk, a lack of determination. And Perry had said, "I've always been an outstanding character detective, otherwise I'd be dead today. Like if I couldn't judge when to trust somebody. You can't, never can much, but I've come to trust you, Dick. You'll see I do, because I'm going to put myself in your power. I'm going to tell you something I never told anybody, not even Willie J, about the time I fixed a guy." And Perry saw as he went on that Dick was interested. He was really listening. "It was a couple of summers ago, out in Vegas. I was living in this old boarding house. It used to be a fancy cat house. But all the fancy was gone. It was a place they should have torn down 10 years back. Anyway, it was sort of coming down by itself. The cheapest rooms were in the attic, and I lived up there. So did this nigger. His name was King. He was a transient. We're the only two up there, us and a million cucarachas. King, he wasn't too young, but he'd done road work and other outdoor stuff. He had a good build. He wore glasses and he read a lot. He never shut his door. Every time I passed by, he was always lying there, buck naked. He was out of work and he said he'd saved a few dollars from his last job, said he wanted to stay in bed a while, read and fan himself and drink beer. The stuff he read, it was just junk, comic books and cowboy junk. He was okay. Sometimes we'd have a beer together. Once he lent me $10. I had no cause to hurt him. But one night we were sitting in the attic. It was so hot you couldn't sleep. So I said, 'Come on, King, let's go for a drive.' I had an old car I'd stripped and souped and painted silver. Silver Ghost, I called it. We went for a long drive. Drove way out in the desert. Out there it was cool. We parked, drank a few more beers. King got out of the car, and I followed after him. He didn't see I'd picked up a chain, bicycle chain I kept under the seat. Actually, I had no real idea to do it until I did it. I hit him across the face, broke his glasses. I kept right on. Afterward, I didn't feel a thing. I left him there. I never heard a word about it. Maybe nobody ever found him, just buzzards." There was some truth in the story. Perry had known, under the circumstances stated, a Negro named King. But if the man was dead today, it was none of Perry's doing. He had never raised a hand against him. For all he knew, King might still be lying abed somewhere, fanning himself and sipping beer. Or did you? Or did you? Did you kill him like you said? Dick asked. Perry was not a gifted liar, or a prolific one, however. Once he'd told a fiction, he usually stuck by it. "Sure I did, only a nigger is not the same." Presently he said, "Know what it is that really bugs me about that other thing? It's just I don't believe it, that anyone can get away with a thing like that." And he suspected that Dick didn't either, for Dick was, at least partly, inhabited by Perry's mystical moral apprehensions. Thus, "Now, just shut up!" The car was moving. 100 feet ahead, a dog trotted along the side of the road. Dick swerved towards it. It was an old, half-dead mongrel, brittle-boned and mangy, and the impact, as it met the car, was little more than what a bird might make. But Dick was satisfied. "Boy," he said, And it was what he always said after running down a dog, which was something he did whenever the opportunity arose. Boy, we sure splattered him! Thanksgiving passed, and the pheasant season came to a halt. But not the beautiful Indian summer with its flow of clear, pure days. The last of the out-of-town newsmen, convinced that the case was never going to be solved, left Garden City. But the case was by no means closed for the people of Finney County, and least of all for those who patronised Holcomb's favourite meeting place, Hartman's Cafe. "Since the trouble started, we've been doing all the business we can handle," Mrs. Hartman said, gazing around her snug domain, every scrap of which was being sat or stood or leaned upon by tobacco-scented, coffee-drinking farmers, farm helpers, ranch hands. "Just a bunch of old women," added Mrs. Hartman's cousin, postmistress Claire, who happened to be on the premises. "If it was spring and work to be done, they wouldn't be here, but wheat's in, winter's on the way. They got nothing to do but sit around and scare each other. You know Bill Brown? Down to the Telegram? See the editorial he wrote? That one he called it, Another Crime? Said it's time for everyone to stop wagging loose tongues. Because that's crime too, telling plain out lies. But what can you expect? Look around you. Rattlesnakes, varmints, rumour mongers. See anything else? Ha! Like dash you do." One rumour originating in Hartman's Cafe involved Taylor Jones, a rancher whose property adjoins River Valley Farm. In the opinion of a good part of the cafe's clientele, Mr. Jones and his family, not the Clutters, were the murderer's intended victims. "It makes harder sense," argued one of those who held this view. "Taylor Jones, he's a richer man than Herb Clutter ever was. Now, pretend the fellow who done it wasn't anyone from hereabouts. Pretend he'd been maybe hired to kill, and all he had was instructions on how to get to the house. Well, it would be mighty easy to make a mistake. Take a wrong turn, and end up at Herb's place, instead of Taylor's." The Jones theory was much repeated, especially to the Joneses, a dignified and sensible family who refused to be flustered. A lunch counter, a few tables, an alcove harbouring a hot grill, and an icebox and a radio. That's all there is to Hartman's Cafe. "But our customers like it," said the proprietress. "Got to. Nowhere else for them to go. Lest they drive 7 miles one direction or 15 the other. Anyway, we run a friendly place and the coffee's good since Mabel came to work." Mabel being Mrs. Helm. "After the tragedy, I said, 'Mabel, now you're out of a job, why don't you come give me a hand at the cafe? Cook a little. Wait counter.' How it turned out. The only bad feature is, everybody comes in here. They pester her with questions about the tragedy. But Mabel's not like Cousin Mert, or me. She's shy. Besides, she doesn't know anything special, no more than anybody else." But by and large, the Hartman congregation continued to suspect that Mabel Helm knew a thing or two that she was holding back. And of course she did. Dewey had had several conversations with her, and had requested that everything they said be kept secret. Particularly, she was not to mention the missing radio or the watch found in Nancy's shoe, which is why she said to Mrs. Archibald William Warren Brown, "Anybody reads the papers knows as much as I do, more, because I don't read them." Square, squat, in the earlier 40s, an Englishwoman fitted out with an accent almost incoherently upper class, Mrs. Archibald William Warren Brown did not at all resemble the cafe's other frequenters, and seemed within that setting like a peacock trapped in a turkey pen. Once, explaining to an acquaintance why she and her husband had abandoned family estates in the north of England, exchanging their hereditary home, oh, the jolliest, oh, the prettiest old priory, for an old and highly unjolly farmhouse on the plains of western Kansas, Mrs. Warren Brown said, "Taxes, my dear, death duties, enormous, criminal death duties. That's what drove us out of England. Yes, we left a year ago, without regrets, none. We love it here, just adore it. Though, of course, it's very different from our other life. The life we've always known, Paris and Rome, Monte, London. I do occasionally think of London. Oh, I don't really miss it. The frenzy. Never a cab. Always worrying about how one looks. Positively not. We love it here. I suppose some people, who those aware of our past, the life we've led, wonder, aren't we the tiniest bit lonely? But out there in the wheat fields, out west, is where we're meant to settle. Wyoming or Nevada, la vraie chose. We hoped when we got there some oil might stick to us, but on our way we stopped to visit friends in Garden City. Friends of friends, actually, but they couldn't have been kinder. Insisted we linger on, and we thought, well, why not? Why not hire a bit of land and start ranching or farming, which is a decision we still haven't come to, whether to ranch or farm? Dr. Austin asked if we didn't find it perhaps too quiet. Actually, no. Actually, I've never known such bedlam. It's noisier than a bomb raid. Train whistles, coyotes, monsters howling the bloody night long. A horrid racket. And since the murders, it seems to bother me more. So many things do. Our house, what an old creaker it is. Mark you, I'm not complaining. Really, it's quite a serviceable house. It has all mod cons, but oh, how it coughs and grunts. And after dark, when the wind commences, that hateful prairie wind, one hears the most appalling moans. I mean, if one's a bit nervy, one can't help imagining silly things. Dear God, that poor family. No, we never met them. I saw Mr. Clutter once in the Federal Building. Early in December, in the course of a single afternoon, two of the cafe's steadiest customers announced plans to pack up and leave, not merely Finney County, but the state. The first was a tenant farmer who worked for Lester McCoy, a well-known western Kansas landowner and businessman. He said, I had myself a talk with Mr. McCoy. Tried to let him know what's going on out here in Holcomb and hereabouts, how a body can't sleep. My wife can't sleep and she won't allow me, so I told Mr. McCoy, I like his place fine, but he'd better hunt up another man. Count of we're moving on, down to East Colorado, maybe then I'll get some rest. The second announcement was made by Mrs. Hideo Ashida, who stopped by the cafe with three of her four red-cheeked children. She lined them up at the counter and told Mrs. Hartman, give Bruce a box of Cracker Jack. Bobby wants a Coke. Bonnie Jean, we know how you feel, Bonnie Jean, but come on, have a treat. Bonnie Jean shook her head, and Mrs. Ashida said, Bonnie Jean's sort of blue. She don't want to leave here, the school here, and all her friends. Why say, said Mrs. Hartman, smiling at Bonnie Jean, that's nothing to be sad over. Transferring from Holcomb to Garden City High, lots more boys. Bonnie Jean said, you don't understand. Daddy's taking us away to Nebraska. Bess Hartman looked at the mother as if expecting her to deny the daughter's allegation. It's true, Bess, Mrs. Ashida said. I don't know what to say, said Mrs. Hartman, her voice indignantly astonished and also despairing. The Ashidas were a part of the Holcomb community everyone appreciated. A family likably high spirit, yet hard-working and neighbourly and generous, though they didn't have much to be generous with. Mrs. Ashida said, we've been talking on it a long time. Hideo, he thinks we can do better somewhere else. When you plan to go? Soon as we sell up, but anyway, not before Christmas, on account of a deal we worked out with the dentist about Hideo's Christmas present. Me and the kids, we're giving him 3 gold teeth for Christmas. Mrs. Hartman sighed. I don't know what to say, except I wish you wouldn't. Just up and leave us. She sighed again. Seems like we're losing everybody one way and another. Gosh, you think I want to leave? Mrs. Ashida said. Far as people go, this is the nicest place we have ever lived. But Hideo, he's the man, and he says we can get a better farm in Nebraska. And I'll tell you something, Bess. Mrs. Ashida attempted a frown, but her plump, round, smooth face could not quite manage it. We used to argue about it. Then one night I said, OK, you're the boss, let's go. After what happened to Herb and his family, I felt something around here had come to an end. I mean, personally, for me. And so I quit arguing. I said, OK. She dipped a hand into Bruce's box of Cracker Jack. Gosh, I can't get over it. I can't get it off my mind. I liked Herb. Did you know I was one of the last to see him alive? Aha! Me and the kids.
We'd been to the 4-H meeting in Garden City. He gave us a ride home. The last thing I said to Herb, I told him how I couldn't imagine his ever being afraid. That, no matter what the situation was, he could talk his way out of it. Thoughtfully, she nibbled a kernel of crackerjack, took a swig of Bobby's Coke, and then said, "Funny, but you know, Bess, I'll bet he wasn't afraid. I mean, however it happened, I'll bet right up to the last moment he didn't believe it would, because it couldn't. Not to him."